5:30 a.m. and we're here in Bodega Bay, California to go crabbing. It is, oh, wrong way again.
Turn left on Duran Park Road.
Winter is prime crabbing season for California, but it may not be forever. Over the past few years, seasons have been delayed for weeks or even months. And instead of just working, people in the fishing industry find themselves debating warming seas, toxic algae, big oil, and a lawsuit. The whole business seems under siege. I have a lot of questions, but the answers are a few miles offshore with a crab fisherman named Dick Ogg.
Oh no! Okay, we'll see you soon. Bye. He said he was about to take off without us.
Dick's the captain of the Karen Jean, and his crew are Sam Davis, McLean Villamere, and Nessa and Buster.
No, are you gonna let us in?
We're driving roughly 20 miles out to a string of crab pots that Dick's bringing in for the season. And while Dick drives, the crew heads down for a nap.
All right. I don't think anything's gonna happen. If it does, I'll call you.
There's a room under there. It just disappeared into the floor. We left from Spud Point Marina in Bodega Bay. We've been out for about an hour and 20 minutes so far, and the sun's just come up. And we're heading to just off the Point Reyes Lighthouse, where we're gonna go collect some crab pots.
Dick chose that spot partly because this past fall, crabs further north tested positive for elevated levels of domoic acid. It's a neurotoxin that causes something called amnesic shellfish poisoning, which can lead to stomach problems, but also dizziness, short-term memory loss, seizures, and sometimes death. So before each season starts, California officials test crabs for it. Amnesic shellfish poisoning has mainly been linked with shellfish, like razor clams and mussels. California's never actually had a confirmed case from crabs. And to keep it that way, officials closed off the area with contaminated crabs for weeks.
You detect domoic acid that delays the season. What does that mean for your bottom line, for how much crabs you catch, how much money you make?
The biggest impact's probably to the public perception. You know, are we eating tainted crabs? Is this gonna make us sick?
Closures cause other problems too. Smaller crabbing outfits might be forced to fish more remote areas. Delays could mean losing out on holiday crab sales and might increase the risk that whales get snagged on crab gear. And everyone is forced to compete in tighter quarters.
You close off an area, now the guys can't fish here. And let's say we know there's a lot of crabs down in at the point here. Well, what do you think the guys are gonna do? They're gonna say, hey, you know, we're gonna go down here, we're gonna all throw our gear out everywhere. I mean, you can darn near walk on the buoy sometimes. There's so many people around you, you know, so.
Domoic acid is produced by a type of algae that blooms almost yearly up and down California. These blooms aren't always toxic. There's some combination of nutrients, light, and most importantly, warm water that sets the stage for an outbreak. And Dick's noticed that the water is getting warmer.
The water temperature, I'll show you right here, the water temperature is 54 degrees right here. Typically this time of year, as you get towards March and April, we used to see 49 degrees.
In 2013, a blob of weirdly warm water appeared off the Pacific coast and stayed there for years. It helped kick off a toxic bloom that poisoned the food chain, forcing California's Dungeness crab fishery to close for months in the 2015-2016 season.
Katie. Dan, a quiet night here in the harbor, and it's going to stay that way for who knows how long.
It was a federal fishery disaster that, by one estimate, cost the state's Dungeness crab industry at least $48 million. But the big question is, going forward, who should pay to help the industry adapt? Scientists predict these warm water events could get more common as we pump more fossil fuel emissions into the air. So this fishery disaster could just be the beginning. 8 a.m. The seasickness hits.
I'm just turning a little green, just a little bit. I'm not gonna puke.
As we approach the crab pots, the crew suits up and gets to work. McLean hooks the buoy, feeds it into the winch. The guys reel it in, open it up, dump the crabs, and measure them. The small ones and the females go overboard. And the males go into that tank. Sam shows me how the whole process works.
So, what are we doing here? Like that?
Yep, and then measure them from this horn there to that horn there.
Okay, horn to horn. So this one's too small.
So that one's small, so you can go
back.
Lucky
day, you're going back.
By next season, the crabs we tossed back might be big enough to keep, but they also might be contaminated with domoic acid. It's a scary enough prospect that people in the fishing industry are starting to connect some big dots. The way they see it, crab harvests are jeopardized by warmer water. Warmer water is tied to climate change. Climate change is tied to fossil fuels. And fossil fuels are tied, of course, to big oil. Which is how a federation of professional fishing groups decided to sue 30 fossil fuel companies. They want big oil to pay up for the harm to their livelihoods, and they want help surviving climate change in the future. We're on our way back, and I ask Sam and McLean about the lawsuit and about their future in fishing.
This is a dying industry, and I don't see too many small boats surviving in the future. It's all going to be big industry and privatized eventually.
How does it make you feel, like, knowing that the industry you guys love is kind of a dying one?
It's all I know. So it's like, and it's a tradition for me. It's generational. So it's like, it's sad, you know? Like, I don't want to see it go.
The truth is that McLean, really the whole team, feels conflicted about who to blame for warming ocean temperatures.
I would prefer that oil companies do things cleaner and, you know, better, but we can't survive without them because our boat runs on diesel. You know, our hydraulic oil, and we couldn't survive without them, you know. We'd have to go back to sales.
Big oil has known since at least the 1960s that our fossil fuel emissions could warm up the planet. But over the past few years, investigative journalists and researchers have discovered a concerted effort by the fossil fuel industry to downplay the danger. In private communications and scientific papers, for example, ExxonMobil acknowledged the reality of climate change. In mass market ads for the public, the company promoted doubt. And all the while this manufactured debate has raged on, big oil has continued to dominate the market. So it's true, this crew uses a diesel boat. But at this point, they don't really have a choice.
When are we gonna get to see all this footage on TV?
When the guys are done cleaning the bait cups, they head inside where there's a sandwich waiting for them. I don't.
Okay. Yeah, I'm feeling better. Had some ginger ale.
It's around 2 in the afternoon. We reach a dock where the team unloads their gear and the crabs. Then it's back to the Spud Point Marina. Dix noticed the ocean changing, but he's not sure who's to blame for the domoic acid, and he's not sure what to think about the lawsuit. He's affiliated with it through his local fishing association, and he's generally supportive of the effort. But mostly, he just wants crabbing to survive, whatever it takes.
It's a difficult industry at best, and you know, the monetary investment is just massive. It's absolutely massive, and just to get started, it's difficult. And then to have a problem like domoic acid come in into play, it's just, it could be devastating to a person trying to start. So we have to fight for everything we can. You know, the environmental portion of this, I just, you know, it's just so unpredictable. Every single year is different, and we're challenged with, you know, where are we going to go if this area is closed? You know, how are we going to bring our money in if we, you know, if we have to travel and stay down in a certain area and we can't come back home, you know? I mean, things like that are things that we have to consider all the time.
2:30 p.m. The Karen Jean pulls back into the marina. The day's work is done.
I mean, one of the neatest things is when you get to turn the boat off and everything goes silent, you know, and it, you know you're home. And we're home. Nice and quiet. Right, Buster? Huh? You guys happy because we're home? No more sandwiches for you, Buster. Little stinker.